I'm Ethan Hunter, an intern with the Mayor's Office of Communications. Today, I'm here with Latoya McBeth of Covenant House, Director of Support Services. Thank you for speaking with me today.
Absolutely. Thank you for having me, Ethan.
So, what happens here at Covenant House? What do you guys do?
So, Covenant House, Georgia is a safe haven for young people who are experiencing homelessness and escaping trafficking. Our organization, our federation, started over 50 years ago. Covenant House Georgia site has been here since 2000. We have grown tremendously since that time. We started in a Polar Rock community off of Lakewood Avenue, just a 15 to 20 bed shelter at that time. We did not have a lot of support services at that time, and we were blessed in 2012 actually to move over to this property, you know, now on a 7-acre property. We have the capacity to serve well over 100 youth in all of our residential programs, as well as our drop-in center that's located here on our campus. We started that in 2015. And so young people who wanna come in and get their immediate needs met, if you need to take a shower, if you need access to clothing or food, we're able to provide those services. But it's a safe haven for everyone. We welcome everyone. Our pillars are to love unconditionally, to respect absolutely, and to support relentlessly.
What's the process of coming into Covenant House?
Coming in. So we are very proud to be what we call the Covenant House family. And so we speak a lot about Cove Love. That's kind of our slang. Mm-hmm. So if a young person comes to us, and they come to us in many different ways, we have a street outreach team that goes out in the evenings, also during the daytime, to just let people know who we are, make young people aware that we exist. And so some of our young people come through our street outreach team. They may show up at our community service drop-in center. We partner with a lot of school systems, with the Department for Family and Child Services. And so it's typically word of mouth in terms of how people show up at Covenant House's door. When a young person comes to us, we're really mindful that they are coming to us with layers and layers of trauma. So they're coming to us in crisis, right? And so we're very mindful to not be super structured around the intake process. Nobody wants to be interviewed when they're coming in, you know, fresh off the streets. If young people are open, though, to doing that intake process, we move forward with that. But a lot of times you just want to take a shower, right? You just want a hot plate of food. You want some new, fresh clothes to put on. And we're very mindful of that. So when a youth comes to us, we truly meet them where they are. And so we do the intake process. They go through an orientation phase. You get a youth handbook. So, you know, we front load, right, what our expectations are, what resources are available to you. The week you come in, you're also assigned a case manager. So you're not out here on this journey alone, right? You're assigned a case manager that's helping you build out your succession plan, helping you establish what your goals are and what you want to accomplish while you're here. And during that time, you really just matriculate through the program by being introduced to our support services, which entails any clinical services that you may need, if you have physical issues that you may need to address. A lot of young people that come to us, this is the first time they're seeing like a primary care physician, right? And so we really want them to understand what's going on with their bodies physically, but also emotionally. We have workforce development programming on our site. Youth come to us at different levels of their workforce experience, some not having any, but some having, you know, some workforce experience. And so we support them with creating resumes. If you want to go out and look for a job, we teach them all the soft skills that they need to know: resume, cover letter, conflict resolution, personal branding, marketing, all the things you need to know to be successful in a job space, right? And then also academic support. If you have bounced around from foster home to foster home, if you've been couch surfing, if you've been displaced in any way, 9 times out of 10, education isn't at the top of the totem pole for you in terms of getting back engaged. So it's really important for us to get young people just excited about learning again. There's a lot of trauma, I hate to say this, around the school system. If you've been bullied in the school system, or if you've been kind of unfortunate to maybe have some teachers or some people around you that judge you based off your behavior rather than your trauma, right? School isn't the thing you're jumping up in the air about. And so we really are trying to expose our young people to the fact that learning is a lifelong endeavor for all of us. So our learning communities is a student-to-student model. We're not teaching them anything. We're teaching each other. And so really compiling those mental health services, the physical support, workforce development, academic support. We do a lot of enrichment activities, so we expose our young people to a lot as well, meaning that you may be in the garden. Mm-hmm. We have a garden on our campus. We have chickens on our campus. Wow. So, you know, being exposed to fresh eggs and being able to cook with the harvest that you yourself grew. And so we understand the therapeutic realm around all of that as well. We take a lot of field trips and outings. We do a lot of college tours, career panels. And so I'm sure I'm leaving some things out, but all of those things packaged together really puts together the holistic way that we're serving our young people who are experiencing homelessness.
What do you think is the main cause of youth homelessness?
It is pretty complex.
It is.
It's pretty complex. I don't know that there is one cause. Honestly, a lot of it could be generational, right? So a lot of generational poverty, a lot of generational instability. There's a lot of work to be done with the different systems that are put in place to keep our young people safe. I think Atlanta in itself is kind of a hub for homelessness and especially for trafficking. When you have a group or, you know, a population of people who have just experienced hardship before they were even born, just generationally, there's just a lot of skills and knowledge and confidence that you don't necessarily have about yourself. And unfortunately, people prey on that. And when people sense or smell, a predator can kind of smell vulnerability from a mile away, right? And unfortunately, we have people that take advantage of those opportunities. And so I don't think there's one thing, you right. know. I think there also is a lot of judgment sometimes that goes into it. There's a lack of people being trauma-informed. And so if I'm someone on the corner, for instance, experiencing homelessness, someone pulling a button in their car may think, oh, this person was just lazy, right? They didn't want to get a job. They didn't want to save money. We are not all on the same playing field by any means. And I think having that mentality of that, you know, if I can work, they can work. If I can save money, they can save money. If I can have a home, they can have a home. Probably not the right mindset to have, because that just simply is not true.
What does a company house do about people who prefer living in an unsheltered area, or how do you feel like that affects the city's cleanliness and liveliness?
Yeah, you know, we have that here. We experience that. And I honestly think that that just comes from a place of distrust. It's very important for us when young people come to us that nothing is routine, you know, or that feels staged. It's really a lot of relationship building, breaking down walls, breaking down barriers, and building trust and confidence, right? We're essentially strangers to them. And so if they come from systems that they haven't been able to trust, if they come from family members that they haven't been able to trust, who are we, you know, to come into their lives and tell them how they should be able to do things. And so, you know, we take our time, we're very patient with that process. And sometimes we get to a place where young people do trust us and, you know, reside within our programming, or they allow us to help them get to secure and stable housing. That, though, takes time. We do experience a lot of people, especially through street outreach and through our drop-in center, that are just simply not ready to come into programming. And that is okay. We are not trying to force anyone to come into our programming. When our street outreach team goes out, they're not coming back with a van load of youth to come into our program. That's not what it looks like. It looks like us going out to hand out food, to talk and have candid conversations about their experience, to give out hygiene kits. And over time, they may come into programming. Same thing with our drop-in center as well. That's our bridge to residential programming. However, you still may not be ready just because they came in to take a shower. They came in and were able to get clothing. So we have people who are actually residing within this space, but outside of our shelter. So I'm staying close enough, right, connected to Covenant House to feel safe, but I'm not ready to come into that type of programming yet. And so we don't force that. We just wait until they're ready. We meet them where they are. I think in terms of image and cleanliness and what that looks like for a city, like Atlanta, where people frequent, I think that in itself is complex. I do think that it poses an issue. It's more so, excuse me, like a public health crisis, so to speak. I'm not really more so concerned with the look of things because I'm not an image person. I believe in service, but really more so the health of those individuals and the safety of those individuals that are choosing to sleep outside on the streets. Community is really the only answer to this. Turning a corner, getting people to shift their mindset and understand that it takes a community of us to wrap our arms around these people who are not just experiencing homelessness. A lot of times it's they're experiencing mental health challenges. And so really taking the stigma away from what mental health looks like and what people feel like it is, and really helping people feel supported, helping people feel loved, making people feel welcomed, not having so many barriers to housing. I think there's a lot of rules there as if, you know, it's not a human right, and right. Everyone deserves a good, clean, stable space to be. But when you don't feel welcome, right, you'd rather be somewhere else. And unfortunately, sometimes that somewhere else is on the streets of Atlanta.
Thank you, Ms. Latoya McBeth, for speaking with me today. It's been a pleasure. Absolutely. Talking with you, having this conversation with you.
Thank you.